Clear. If the king told me move right, I have to come and tell you the king says move right. Two steps right, one step right, four steps right. This is my point of view. If Jesus was sent by God as a mission to get the sins of all human beings, this is the first thing he's going to make clear. I'll tell you why. If Jesus is God, he doesn't fear anyone. He controls destiny. He cannot fear anyone who's going to crucify him or kill him before that. He knows where he's going to go, where he's going to land, what's going to happen. You understand? So Jesus knows everything. If he's God, he has to know everything. If he knows everything, he will come make his mission clear. Why? Because if his mission is not clear, we don't have salvation. We will go to hellfire if we didn't understand his message. Why? Because you need to, in order to go to heaven in Christian religion, you have to believe Jesus died for your sins. So if Jesus didn't make it clear that he died for our sins, and we didn't believe it, we're not going to go to heaven. You understand what I'm trying to say? So when you say...
Everything should happen. Like, if you or me, if we would have made a plan, maybe a lot of things would go differently, but we didn't make the plan. So I guess that's things we can't...
But you believe Jesus was coming in a plan?
Yeah.
By God himself, right?
Yeah, but I think the plan is made of God, and God has had everything under control and had a perfect plan. If you or me made a plan, maybe I would do something like make it clear.
I'll be honest, I'll give you the reply that Christians say. So I'll work with you. I'll give you the reply that when I tell people, why didn't Jesus say that he's God? The reply that Christians give me. So they say he didn't say he's God because he was going to be crucified. He cannot say it. He will be blaspheming and he's going to be crucified. So he had to be ambiguous in telling parables to people. This is what they say. So I tell them, okay, fine. Let's agree there. But why didn't Jesus tell his own disciples? His disciples believe in him. They're not going to crucify him. Why did he tell his own disciples, John, I'm God coming as a mission to human beings to take your sins? You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I don't know, but actually, I don't have to know.
Yeah, sure, you don't have to. I'm not claiming that you have to know. But I'll tell you the Muslim point of view, and you tell me what you disagree with.
I think that just, it wasn't God's plan to just go on earth and tell them, here I am God. It was his plan to show his... I think that for the disciples, it would have been too much for them to just be hit by...
No, at the end of the ministry. At the end of the ministry. I'm not saying in the beginning. Look, at the very end, anytime.
I think it was just... Or the way...
Can I tell you something?
It comes to me is that it was just God's plan to teach his children to know by themselves that he was.
Okay.
And not to just tell them.
Okay. Can I tell you the problem with that? If Muslims today, respectfully, by the way, if Muslims today saw a different point of view of Jesus, which is logical, which is supported by the scripture, that Jesus is not God, Jesus is a normal human being who came as a prophet, and another prophet came after him, which we can establish he's a prophet, which is Prophet Muhammad, which affirmed that he's not God, okay? And the Trinity didn't exist in the Bible. Can God be unjust by punishing the Muslims when they had a valid point of view in reading the scripture? You see, this problem will arise if God did not make it clear. But if God made it clear, 100%, we cannot say, come and say Jesus is not God. Why? Because he said. If he said, you cannot play around with it. He doesn't have to say, I'm God. He can say, worship me. You see? Pray to me. He doesn't have to say literally, I'm God. You understand what I'm trying to say? But he has to make it clear. So, I'll give you an example. Does God have a God above him? If Jesus said he has a God, can he be God?
He's a father.
Is the Father his God or God with him in one essence? The Father is God in him in one being, right?
Yeah.
But he's not his God. His God means my God. When you say my God, and you understand? My God, like Germans would say. So, you know what Jesus said? I'll try it in German a bit.
I think you want to respond to the last words. My God, why did you...
No. Why did you forsake me? No. Another one. This is a good one, but another one.
John 20, 17.
So
what? He says, I go to my father and your father.
So he says, I'll go to meine Vater and deine Vater, meine Gott and deine Gott. Okay? This is what he says. I'll go to my father and your father, my God and your God. So if he says my God and your God, he's showing us he has the same God. If he says my father and your father, he's showing us he has the same father. In this dialect, he's showing the people, in this discussion, I mean in these words, he's showing the people that he has a God above him. Then when he went to the Garden of Gethsemane and he was praying, as I was telling you, he was praying to his own God. If you see him today praying, prostrating, will you pray to him or with him? The natural thing that you pray with him, right? To God. He's praying, prostrating, putting his forehead on the ground. We will pray with him to God. This is the natural instinct. When we see someone praying to someone else, putting his forehead on the ground, we do the same. So this, Jesus was trying to give us this message. I'll give you another example. If I say, I forgot your name, sorry.
It doesn't matter, Marcel.
Marcel. Okay, if I say Marcel, I'll ask you this question. I'm gonna praise him right now. If I say Marcel is the only true man in Speaker's Corner. It's a big claim, is it? Okay. If I say Marcel is the only true man in Speaker's Corner, all the other men will be false men. They cannot be true men, right? Because he's the only true man in Speaker's Corner. I want you to think with me, hear with me. If Jesus says the only true God is the Father, can he be God as well?
For me, it's not that. It's not a conflict.
Tell me a point of view. Tell me a point of view. I want to hear your point of view.
I came not that prepared to this.
No, no, I'm not trying to debate, by the way.
So I guess it's done that like
okay.
20 times.
No problem. No, no. Sure, sure. I'll tell you something. You're right. I totally respect that. Look, if I came here for my first time and someone is coming shooting at me things, for sure I wouldn't be able to answer these kind of questions. So I'm not here to prove a point, even
why,
though
why
all of this...
You said it's not a conflict. Why is it not a conflict?
I just believe.
Because you believe in a Trinity. You believe the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit are God, right? But that is actually contradictory to what Jesus believes. Jesus, when, as he said the verse in John chapter 17, verse 3, he says that this is eternal life, that they know you, he's referring to the Father, you, the only true God. So according to Jesus, who was the only true God? The Father. According to you guys, who is the only true God? The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So you see there's association of extra partners to God, which we as Muslims call shirk. Associating partners with God is not something that Jesus advocated, not something that Moses advocated, not something any of the prophets advocated. They all believed in one God, and that God is always, in the Hebrew language, they call it Abba.
I have to make something clear now, okay? Kind of, in a dramatic way, okay? I have to make something clear now. The only reason we're here, me and him and all the Muslims, is one thing, is to convey the message. So when I'm telling you about this kind of things, do you know why I'm telling you? To go home and do your research. You know why? Because if this depends, our salvation depends on that. You know what salvation is? Afterlife.
Yeah.
The life afterlife, all of it depends on this. So we cannot take gamble here. We have to be sure that what we believe in is the truth. You understand what I'm trying to say? So when we come, we give a message to someone, all we're trying to do is to convey the message of Islam, convey the true message of God, which we believe is the true message. And you have the right to believe whatever you want to believe. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I'm not trying to tell you guys start believing this or don't believe in that or this is wrong, this is wrong. No, this is completely, I'm not trying to do that.
It's good to hear.
You know what? Putting you on that spot is just for you to ponder upon the things that we discuss. Consider it as a dialogue. Not to put you in a corner or anything.
So don't think I'm prepared bringing my evidence. It's not about that totally. So but not this paper that people come here with. So let me tell you something. Okay. This will be a different question. Let's now put aside Christianity, okay? Have you guys looked into Islam?
Not so much.
Never.
Yeah, well, in school.
Partially, but
a period by the teach different religions.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like
so
all
what did
you have the same
what's your,
religious education?
What's your basic idea of Islam? The basics, just the basics, you know.
It's hard to put it into a few words.
Okay. So I'll tell you Islam in a few seconds right now. A few minutes. Few seconds. Okay. So Islam is first we have five pillars of faith. Okay? The first pillar of faith is to say there is no God but Allah, one true God. Allah, by the way, this is, I want to clarify, advocate more on Allah. Allah is a word that it describes the one true God only.
Okay. Yeah.
So, you know, like the German word, Gott, it can refer to singular and plural. Can be male and female, correct?
Yeah.
Allah cannot.
True
so Allah
false.
Is gender neutral.
Yeah.
Allah is not singular or plural, you know?
Yeah.
That's why we use it. Coptic Christians in Egypt, they use the same. Jews, they use it. Why? Because it means the only true God, Allah. That's why we use it. So believing in Allah, meaning believing in the only true God, who's genderless, he doesn't have a gender, he's above gender. Okay? You probably agree with that. And believing that Prophet, sure. And believing that Prophet Muhammad is the Prophet of God. This is the second part of the first pillar of faith. The second one is, we give charity, or we do prayer. We do prayer, 5 prayers a day. Have you seen Muslims pray? Just exactly like Jesus or Moses, Abraham, you know? So we kneel, we put our forehead on the ground. Why? Because this shows you humility as a human being towards the Creator. I can pray this way, or this way, for example, but this doesn't show humility towards the Creator. When I put my forehead on the ground, I show my humility like Jesus did, to the Creator, to the higher being. I'm showing my humility, you know? I'm asking Him for guidance, I'm asking Him for everything. So this is how we pray as Muslims. We pray 5 times a day. We remember God 5 times a day.
Jesus did that as well when he prayed, didn't he?
Yeah, yeah, I told
he put
him.
His face on the floor, yeah.
Yes. Yeah, we have other ones as well.
Why is it 5 times?
Why is it 5 times? That's a very good question. In the beginning they were not 5, they were more. But they were decreased because human beings cannot bear more than that. So because God knows us, knows the capacity of human beings, we will only be able to do 5, and most of the people now are even being lazy in doing 5, you know? So 5 prayers, because you remember God every time of the day. The Quran says, prayer forbids you from doing all evil. If I remember God 5 times every day, the minute I think about evil, the prayer times comes, I go to pray, I forget the evil I want to do, you understand?
Yes.
So it's something that prevents you from doing evil. We pray dawn time, we pray when the sun is there, the sun is about to set, sunset, and night time. So these times during the day we remember God. We stop ourselves from doing bad things and we be grateful to the Creator. The Creator gave us everything. Did we thank the Creator enough for what He gave us? I'll give you one example. Can you count your heartbeats? This is one blessing. If we can count our heartbeats, maybe we can thank God for our heartbeats. If there's 10,000 heartbeats, we thank 10,000 times.
Yeah.
But we can't even count our heartbeat, let alone our eyes, our breath, all these blessings of God. So this praying of God is a form of being grateful. Every day 5 times being grateful to the Creator. Every day 5 times
okay.
Being grateful to God.
But 5 is just...
Sorry?
Yeah, no. If it would be more, you would be able to do anything.
Yes. It would be too hard for human beings to follow the
Creator. Someday it just came to that dynamic.
Sorry?
Someday...
I think she wants to point out why is it the specific number 5 and,
yes.
And not number 4.
That it's more.
it's God. Yes. Basically, it's God's command at the end
yes.
of the day.
So, as he said, at the end of the day, it's God's command. But this question can be asked. I'll tell you the problem with this question. I could say, why is it 5? But it could have been 3. I would say, why is it 3? If it's 2, I would say, why is it 2?
Yeah.
So you see, you will ask the question every time, you see what I'm saying?
Like Jesus, he fasted so, for 40 days, why not 41?
You see? I understand what you're saying.
I know, a reason
for being 5, that's why you're asking, I'm sure. So it's just a God, don't worry, you will see this a lot to speak as So, it's just a command by God that there are 5 prayers, because they could have been 5, 6, 11, you know? Just a number, 5 prayers a day. For the 5 times of day of remembering God 5 times. We have fasting and charity. These are the 2 other pillars. So charity, this is why I want you to look at this concept of charity. Charity in Islam is zakah. Zakah means purification. You purify yourself from your desires, from your being a greedy person by giving to others. You purify yourself. So we have to give obligatory charity. If you are wealthy enough, you have wealth, you're a wealthy person, you're a rich man, unlike myself. You're a rich man. Okay, I'm not rich. And you have to give 2.5% of your wealth every year to the poor. So I want you to imagine this. You heard of Bill Gates, probably, okay? And you heard of the owner of Amazon, the richest guy in the world. I want you to imagine these two, giving every year 2.5%. Done. All the poor people in the street have food, have shelters. So Islam solves the problems in society by the pillars of faith. You understand?
First, that can be solved.
Sorry?
The problems that can be solved.
Yes, that can be solved. Islam solves, you know.
Not 100% everything is money, you're right.
Yes.
The majority of...
I just wanted to... Yeah.
Sure. No, sure, no problem. We agree with it anyways, no problem. The next one is the fasting. Fasting is another way of losing your desires. Not every time I want to eat, to drink, to have sexual intercourse, to do this, to do that, I do it. No, I'm not an animal. The animal follows his desires. I'm able to control my human, my desires. So we fast 1 month from Ramadan, which is very soon coming, if you like to fast or something. So we fast this month, okay? We control our desires. We follow the command of God. We feel the state of losing the blessing, which is the poor people who don't have food, don't have money, don't have anything. We feel their state when we don't eat. You understand? We feel their feeling. You can appreciate. You see what I'm saying? Yes. So fasting is a very vast thing as well. Gives you piety. You don't. Fasting is not about food only in Islam. It's about sexual intercourse, cursing, getting angry. You know. So it's a form of controlling yourself. A complete form of controlling your willpower, your desires, everything. And the last one is pilgrimage, which we do as Mecca, which is a form of killing racism in a big way. So we all go wearing the same thing, performing the same action, doing the same things under one name, which is God. Which kills racism. Likewise, the prayers every day. So prayers every day, we're praying at one line. The janitor next to the owner of the company, next to the boss, next to Bill Gates when he becomes Muslim.
If he's more...
The person who's qualified to lead the prayer is the one who memorizes more Quran, who's more pious towards God. So there is no discrimination there. You see, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said in his last sermon, he said, there is no difference between the black and the white, the Arab and the non-Arab. The only difference is piety towards the Creator. And the Quran affirms that. It says, we have made you into different nations and tribes. So you can get to know each other. The best of you is the one who's more pious towards the Creator. So this is, in a nutshell, is the message of Islam, which if you look into it in depth, when you look at the life of Jesus in depth, you'll find out that he was following the same.
All the prophets, actually. Most of them followed these... Except for the Hajj,
yes. You will see. I know you're feeling a bit like I'm trying to impose. Yes, I can feel that a bit. So I want you to tell me what you think about Islam in general. In general, about what I said.
Well, it
too
does
much, yeah.
Sound very good what you say.
Okay.
It's hard for us only hearing what you say to judge the whole religion.
Sure. And no, I'm not trying. I'm only trying to ask you your opinion of what I said.
I mean, everything you said does sound good, and I think that Christianity, if all the Christians would, stay true to the commandments we believe in, it would be quite similar, and you could solve a lot of problems too if everyone would, follow the way.
Do you think it's going to be the same? So I'll give you some examples. Sure, go ahead. Yeah.
Sometimes it's hard for me to explain in English, but when...
Maybe try German, I might understand.
I just wanted to ask, at the end, Jesus didn't came to the world to form Christianity or to build a church or to something.
Yes.
He doesn't care. He didn't use the word Christianity or... I don't know.
Do you know who used Christianity, the first one?
No.
It was the Romans who killed Jesus.
Yeah, but
so?
You know what I'm saying? At the end, that word... doesn't matter.
The what?
The word.
The teachings. The word doesn't matter. Yes, I agree with you.
Yeah.
The message is what you're saying.
Right.
Yeah. Do you know?
The
message
is the important thing, and not every detail of how you put the message into
the message with regards to saving you. What was the message of Jesus?
This is what he's trying to say.
How can you be saved according to the message of Jesus and Christianity?
Love one another. I think that's the most important thing. You know.
Sorry, what is that? Love?
Love one another.
Love one another and love your God. Like.
No, but can you be saved by just doing that?
No, you just save because of the death of Jesus Christ.
So do you have to believe in the crucifixion, for example, in order to be saved?
If I wouldn't believe in that, I would have to force myself to go through strict rules every day. Because if I would only think that this would save me, you know what I'm saying? It's hard for me to...
I absolutely understand what you're saying. Because there's a verse in the Bible, in Hebrews, I think 9:22, where it says there's no forgiveness without the shedding of blood. Now, you see, the shedding of blood is, I think, quite important for the Christian faith.
Yeah, because
and for salvation.
But before Jesus came, if you had done something wrong, you had to like shot, I don't know, from you have to bring it in, sacrifice an animal or something like that. Yeah. But after that, you don't have to do it.
But what about the concept of forgiveness?
Do you think
God is not able to forgive? Do you think human sacrifice is a necessary thing for God?
Can I tell you what he's trying to say? What he's trying to say is, do we have to limit God by saying that God? You will see what I'm saying. By saying that God is not able to forgive us, he needs sacrifice to forgive us. So I'll give you an example.
No, he doesn't need.
He doesn't need. Correct.
No, but he's just.
He chose.
He's just.
Say it in German, no problem.
He's just.
And if he's a good, to point out of view of the picture of the judge can clearly say that was good and that was wrong. He can forgive.
Okay.
But if he, in the Bible says, or everything says, that he's just.
I agree with you. I like that you brought this point, but I hope I don't be disrespectful, but I'm going to say right now. Hear my point and think about it, okay? God is just, correct? If my friend here, he didn't do anything bad in his life. I'm praising you again, look.